The Gulf of Mexico is a region famous for oil. But what you might not know is 150 miles from Houston, Texas, surrounded by drilling platforms, is one of the healthiest coral reefs in the world.
When you look out, it can be almost disorienting because there's so much coral.
Live boulder corals everywhere.
A thriving, beautiful coral reef off of the Texas-Louisiana border. You wouldn't think of it being out there.
We have these magical underwater places completely surrounded by the oil and gas industry.
As reefs around the world are bleaching at alarming rates, scientists are racing to study and preserve this remarkable coral reef that's holding on in the unlikeliest of places. This is a map of offshore drilling in the Gulf of Mexico. Many of these drill sites are on underwater mountains where oil naturally collects. And right here in the center are the flower garden banks. The history of this reef and the oil deposits that surround it actually starts with an ancient ocean, roughly 190 million years ago. In this hot prehistoric world, this ocean was drying up, leaving behind a massive plain of salt. Over the ages, that dried up layer of salt was buried deep in the earth, and eventually a new sea, the Gulf of Mexico, formed high above it. Because salt is less dense than the surrounding rock, that layer slowly rose up towards the surface, pushing up the earth above it and pulling up massive oil deposits from below. Slowly, this shift created these enormous underwater mountains known as salt domes. And a few of these mountains rose so high that sunlight was just able to filter down through the water to reach them. And roughly 10,000 years ago, coral polyps latched onto these peaks and started to grow. Those underwater mountaintops where the corals landed are now the flower garden banks. Because the reef is so far from the shore, it's been protected from many threats like overfishing and coastal pollution. And because of its depth and northern latitude, the water is about as cold as corals can tolerate, essentially protecting it from global warming. And you can see in the summer of 2023, while other reefs around the Caribbean were being ravaged by heat stress and bleaching, this unique geology at Flower Gardens allowed it to fare better than the rest. Which is kind of ironic, because that same unique geology has also turned the region into a massive hub for offshore drilling.
The Gulf is critical for America's oil supply. It's the primary offshore source of oil and gas.
You're on the dive boat and you look around and you can see oil and gas platforms in every direction.
It is this beautiful reef, you pop up and there's an oil platform.
So there's all of this industry happening around this beautiful place.
For now, the reef has thankfully avoided any catastrophic oil spills. But that doesn't mean that oil hasn't left its mark. In fact, the legacy of oil extraction, carbon emissions, and climate change are quite literally etched on the hard skeletons of the corals themselves.
I think of that skeletal material as this little time capsule.
This is Amy Wagner. Today, she's a scientist who studies corals to find clues about Earth's past. But back in the spring of 2005, she was a graduate student on a scientific dive to complete her PhD. Amy and a team of scientists had traveled all night on a research boat to the flower gardens in search of one very specific type of coral called Sedastria sedaria.
The type of coral that I'm looking at, it's the things that you kind of look at and they just look like a bunch of rocks on the bottom.
The team's goal was to dive down 78 feet to the tops of these ancient mountains and drill a nearly 6-foot-long core of this slow-growing species of coral. Inside would contain a 250-year record of pollution, climate change, and world events. After hours of drilling, they patched up the hole and swam the 6-foot-long core to the surface.
you split them open and you x-ray them, and they're like trees. People are very familiar with tree rings, that you can count the tree rings and go back in time. Well, the corals produce these annual bands.
Every year, the living coral organism lays down a new growth band, using the nutrients and minerals it pulls out of the seawater. Essentially, whatever's in the seawater makes it into that year's layer of coral skeleton.
So we have this long record of these little tiny time capsules that are sort of locking in the ocean chemistry.
By looking at the variations in the different elements in the core over time, scientists like Amy and her colleague Kristine DeLong are able to get an incredible view of the past. Using a high-tech version of a dentist drill, they collect a tiny bit of dust from each growth band, and then, like detectives, they analyze the different elements in the dust for clues. Just like humans, corals build their skeletons out of calcium, but sometimes they make mistakes, accidentally grabbing look-alike elements from the seawater. One of those elements is barium, which is often used as a lubricant in offshore oil wells. During the 1970s energy crisis, oil drilling boomed in the Gulf of Mexico.
Proven pools are being tapped beneath these waters in the Gulf of Mexico.
And you can see that spike reflected in the barium levels in the coral. When oil prices crashed, production went down, and so did the barium. This is just one of the countless hidden histories that scientists have uncovered from this coral core. By looking at nitrogen, they can see the rise of fertilizer pollution from the Mississippi River. By looking at radioactive carbon, they can see the rise of nuclear weapons tests during the Cold War. And the corals even tell the story of how fossil fuels are changing the climate. In the words of one scientist, recording their own demise. Carbon atoms aren't all exactly the same. They actually come in a few different weights. This one is called heavy carbon, and this one is called light carbon. This is useful because plants prefer the light carbon. So inside of a plant, the carbon is a little bit lighter than, say, inside of a volcano. Fossil fuels come from ancient plants, which are full of light carbon. As fossil fuel emissions continue to rise, you can literally see the carbon in our atmosphere getting lighter. And you can see this trend playing out inside of the corals. The carbon in the coral slowly gets lighter as the world burns more fossil fuels. As those fossil fuel emissions warm the climate, reefs around the world are in danger.
Historically off the charts, ocean temperatures
100 degrees Fahrenheit.
The coral is bleaching at what is likely an unprecedented rate.
Today, the flower garden banks are still holding on, and they'll probably outlast many other reefs around the world. But they won't be safe forever. As early as 2040, flower garden banks could start to see major bleaching events every single summer. If we can reduce our emissions at a more reasonable pace, climate models say we might be able to buy an extra 15 to 20 years for the flower garden banks, essentially doubling its window of time to adapt. That window would be critical for the sanctuary staff and independent scientists who are working hard to study and protect what might become one of the last coral reefs.
Going to a place like flower gardens, it's like these corals, they're still pretty darn healthy. Being able to manage those reefs and take care of them is important because they may be the last ones we have.
Recently, scientists have started collecting corals from the reef and storing them in an onshore coral lab. The hope is to eventually bank up enough coral here as a last resort in case the worst happens.
It is a grim prospect. But again, it's a proactive measure. It's better to be proactive and have some things banked versus getting into the situation where all the corals have bleached and died and we have nothing left. It is my hope that nature can adapt, but I think the problem is that, you know, climate is changing quickly enough that there might not be time.
The flower garden banks are a product of 10,000 years of slow, steady growth. Every year, these corals have captured annual snapshots of our changing world in small millimeter-sized chapters. And the next few decades are critical in determining how this ancient undersea story of Earth unfolds.